Crossing the calm sea with Jesus, the disciples were getting concerned. The wind started violently blowing, but he was asleep in the stern. Does he not care that we perish? We're helpless and we're so afraid. Jesus arose when they called him and said to them, where is your faith? Because you prayed all night, cause you held on with all of your might. Child, your cries have awoken the Master. Oh, he knows your voice. Lift your hands, it's time to rejoice. Child, your cries have awoken the Master. It hit you without any warning. The storm of your life had begun. Seeing no hope in the distance, you're frightened and nowhere to run. By now your vessel is filling, and you're thinking that you'll surely drown. You've cried out for help from the Savior, and you know you can't give up now. Because you prayed all night, cause you held on with all of your might. Child, your cries have awoken the Master. Oh, he knows your voice. Lift your hands, it's time to rejoice. Child, your cries have awoken the Master. Now you're up there worrying, and he's fast asleep. The winds are so deadly, the water's so deep. But try to be patient, cause soon he'll bring peace. Just one word from his voice, and it all must cease. Because you prayed all night, cause you held on with all of your might. Child, your cries have awoken the Master. Oh, he knows your voice. Lift your hands, it's time to rejoice. Child, your cries have awoken the Master. Child, your cries have awoken the Master. Oh, he knows your voice.
This song, Brandon says, I should only sing it on Easter, but I think it's a good song for any time. Disciples were gathered in an upper room. Their world was sealed up in a garden tomb. There in the darkness, they were so afraid, unsure of tomorrow and what they might face.
Cause on Friday the Savior died on a cross. Saturday it seemed like all hope was lost. Soon there would be songs of rejoicing, cause everything changes. Come Sunday morning, no one could remember the promise he made, that he'd lay his life down, and in just 3 days the grave would surrender in total defeat. Your death would be swallowed up in victory. Cause on Friday the Savior died on the cross. Saturday it seemed like all hope was lost. Soon there would be songs of rejoicing, cause everything changes. Come Sunday morning, oh, when the angel rolled that stone away, and suddenly there's hope, when just 3 days ago on Friday the Savior died on a cross. Saturday it seemed like all hope was lost. Soon there would be songs of rejoicing, cause everything changes. Oh, on Friday the Savior died on a cross. Saturday it seemed like all hope was lost. There would be songs of rejoicing, cause everything changes. Come Sunday
not Brenda can play this one.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displays. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, when through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation to take me home, oh, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, oh, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Crystal, I would like to thank you for singing that song. Back on September the 2nd of 2016, I had open heart surgery, 5 bypasses. And I was on, 9 days later, more than 3 large blood clots hit each of my lungs. And I was on life support for 6 days. And only thing I remember about that, other than what somebody told me what happened, because I didn't realize that the blood clots had hit and that I was on life support, that I heard the most beautiful choir singing How Great Thou Art. And I told Crystal when I was able to come back to church, I said, will you sing that song? And thank you so much for singing that. Y'all pray for me.
When I look around to see the good things He does for me, I know I'm unworthy of them all.
For His
blessings He freely gives,
just to see what key it was in. But you know, we all as Christians long for the day, and I don't think it's going to be long till we'll be on heaven's bright shore.
Yes.
Out on the hills of glory land,
yes.
So happy and free at God's right hand.
Bless your Lord.
They tell of a place of marvelous grace on heaven's bright shore. Oh, pilgrims on earth, someday we'll go to live in that land forevermore. Just trusting in Him who died for all sin, and He rose
rose from the grave on heaven's bright shore. There's gonna be no more dying over there, not one little grace in all that fair land. Not even a tear will dim the eye, and no one up there will say goodbye, just singing his praise through endless days on heaven's bright shore, that heavenly shore. Now when I must cross that rolling tide, there'll be someone on the other side. Welcome me home to that fair land, made perfect by love. Yes, when I walk up that milky white way, I'll see that homecoming in array. How great it must be for angels to see a pilgrim reach home.
Amen.
On heaven's bright shore, there'll be no more dying over there, not one little grave in all that fair land,
that wonderful land.
Not even a tear will dim the eye, and no one up there will say goodbye, just singing his praise to endless ages
on heaven's bright shore, that heavenly shore. Amen.
You know, next month, if I live to July the 20th, it'll be 44 years since the Lord saved me. And this is my testimony song. I've wore it out 10 times over. It takes me back to where God brought me from, and that was a very dark valley. And he set my feet upon a solid ground. And he's brought me through a lot of things in life, and he's blessed me a lot too. And I just thank him so much. He's always been a friend. He's always there, no matter what time of the night. And I just like to thank him. My eyes are doing really good right now. I'm probably 20/20 in both eyes. And that's pretty good from almost being blind last year. And I just give him the praise for that.
Yes, amen. Bless you, Jesus. We worship you, Lord.
Oh, once I was clothed in the rags of my sin, I was wretched and poor.
If you know it, church, sing it.
Lost and lonely within, but with wondrous compassion, oh, the King of all kings, took me under his wings. Oh, yes, oh, yes. I'm a child of the King. Now his royal blood, it now flows through. Oh, and poor, now I can't sing. Praise God, praise God. Oh, I'm a child of the King.
Yes, I am.
This what's going to make it all worthwhile. Amen. When this life is over, and we'll forever be in a land
where there'll be no more tears,
there'll be no more heartache, there'll be no more sickness. We'll all be peace and joy. God's going to wipe all the tears away, and we'll be able to bow down and give Him the praise that He so richly deserves.
Praise the Lord.
Now I am a child with the heavenly hope. Yes, my holy Father, He has made me His own. Now I'm cleansed by His blood, and I've been redeemed by my Savior. Someday I'm gonna sing with the angels above. Oh yes, oh yes, I'm a child of the King. His royal blood is now flowing. Like to thank the Lord for being here today. If you don't think God performs miracles in this day and time, I am a walking, talking miracle.
Time to turn the order of service over to preaching. And I want you to pray for those that come to bring the message today. And the Bible says that we should always be ready to give answer to the hope that's within us. And I don't know about you, but I have a hope that is anchored to my soul. The Bible says hope is a confident expectation. And I know this, we would have no hope without Jesus, but we have this because of Him. And I want to give Him glory, and I hope you do today. I'm going to call on Brother Ryan to come, if he would, to offer himself. And I want you to pray for him as he comes. And I want you to know this. God is so good. And He is better than anything I've ever found. And you can search this world over if you want to. But you'll never find nothing better than God. Can I get an amen this morning? Let's give the Lord a big old hand. Amen. Brother, come on. You all pray for Brother Ryan as he brings a message this morning. It's a whole lot easier to preach when people are praying for you. It's a whole lot better than when they're throwing rocks at you, ain't it, brother?
for now. Yeah, this one will work. But yes, I had a message of grace on my heart this morning. And in Sunday school, we talked about God's covenant with Noah and the rainbow. And I'll be honest, I've prayed for a message that God would allow me to speak on His grace, on the goodness of God. I know everybody may have never heard me have a message before, but some of them's difficult for me to preach. And I've told my wife many times, you know, I feel like God's always got me giving very hard messages, you know, and that's okay if God wants it that way. But today I believe that God's given me a message of grace and of goodness that I know we forsake sometimes. If we look in Ephesians chapter 2, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, and it's a verse that everybody knows well. Ephesians 2, 8 says, For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. You know, I think we forget sometimes that we're saved by God's grace. I think sometimes we think that there's enough boxes we can check off that we are actually contributing some way or somehow to our salvation. But we are not. We are saved by God, wholly by God. It is of His grace that we're saved. If it was by us, then God would owe us something. And another verse I want to look at is Romans 4, 3 and 4, which says this very thing. Romans chapter 4, verse 3 says, For what says the Scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. Now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. See, if we're saved by anything other than grace, friend, it is as if God owes us something in this life. And you know, even the way of salvation and the way that God has provided a sacrifice and salvation through Jesus Christ, do you see the grace in that? Because I was thinking the other day, and I feel like it's something that I forsook in my mind, is that we're just supposed to be given this way of salvation. We know the way. We know that we've been provided salvation, but we think that that is deserved or owed to us. Well, I'm going to tell you, we fail. Man fell in the garden in the very beginning when sin entered the world. But you know, we're not the only beings or creatures that fail. You see, angels fail. Satan rebelled when he wanted to exalt himself. And other angels fell and followed him. But they did not get any way of salvation or reconciliation or a way of redemption for them. And you know, I had forgotten that a little bit. You know, I had forgotten that God so graciously supplied this way of salvation out of love, out of mercy, and out of just His grace. Unworked favor by God. Now this morning, another thing that God's put on my mind this morning is the thought of a testimony. And some of you may have heard me give a testimony before. What I thought, that I thought that I was good, that I walked this earth and I lived in this life, I thought morally and worldly that I was good enough that God was going to save me come time when I died and when I was going to be judged. I really thought in my mind that I've been good enough. That I think God's going to save me, that I've done enough, I've been good enough to people. But you know, I have a hard time remembering what I done yesterday. I have a hard time remembering what I done a few weeks ago and a month ago. But I'm going to trust myself to remember who I was prior to salvation. And you see, my heart, I say a lot about what I thought of myself. Well, friend, what I think of myself does not matter. If I thought I was good, it does not matter if the Bible contradicts what I thought. So if I go to the Word of God for a testimony of who I was a wicked man. I was an evil man. I was somebody that walked in rebellion every day of my life against the holy, righteous God and the commandments that He laid out before me on how I was supposed to live my life. And because I walked around saying that I was good or that I was a Christian or that I believed, it made no difference, friend. All that matters is what God says. What's in God's Word is always true. But you know, with testimonies, you know, my testimony seemed to sound a little bit difficult for me. Do y'all know what I mean by some testimonies when someone stands to give a testimony and God's delivered them from this deep, dark valley of life, and their testimony, it really seems to be just, for lack of a better sense, kind of better than yours. You know, it does. Some of them seems to just be better. Like, oh man, that testimony is just so wonderful. What God delivered them from, what God done for them, and I'm not taking away from the people that was in those dark and rough valleys of life. But we all have the same testimony, that we were separated from a holy, righteous God, and through His Son, Jesus Christ, by His blood, we was reconciled and brought back into fellowship with Him. That is our testimony. The only difference is they see who they were. You know, these people that's had a really rough life and in this valley, you know, they see who they were. And it's a popular scripture that I bring up all the time in Romans chapter 3. And it's verse 23. And it's for all have sinned. You know, some people understand who they were in that sense more than others do. So if you forget who you were, and I think about the young and the youth, and I'm sure there's older people here that has the same testimony. I've been saved since I was 8 or 9 or 10 years old. That it don't mean as much. And it's not as great of a testimony, but it is. Because the Bible says that you were separated, that you was in a rebellion, that you had sinned. And by Jesus Christ, you was brought back into a right relationship with God. That is everyone. But you know, we talked about this in Sunday school. It's like God's put everything in front of me this morning. You know, Brother Jason said that the covenants that God makes with us, the covenant that He made with Noah, what do we have in today's world, in our life, that we can see that covenant and that we can stand on it and stand firm with what God says. And it's the power of His Word. You know, God said some thousands of years ago that He would never flood this world again and destroy it by water. And every time we look up into the sky and see a rainbow, you see God's promise. You can see it still today, but we forget and we forsake it. It's what does God's Word say? He says He will not flood the world and destroy it by water. We know that it's true. You know that that is true. But what about the other things that God's Word says? What about the other things that maybe not so easy, but we know that they are true?
Yeah. You know, I was laying on a pool float yesterday at my brother's house. I looked up into the sky, and I really do not do this very often, but I was looking at the clouds, and I was looking at the mountains. And I tell you the truth, the most sweetest understanding, I looked over at Keith and I told her, I said, you know what I see when I look up at these clouds and these mountains? The God of all creation, the sustainer of this universe, He knows my name. He knows my name. and then I think, why does he know my name? What did I do to ever deserve to that he would know my name? And I go back to grace. It's all him. That's the only reason. It ain't nothing of myself. And the things in the Bible, me and the kids was talking in the pool, and Hannah Jo, my little Hannah Jo, she says, we're talking about heaven, we're talking about hell, we're talking about things, and she says, well, Dad, you know, everybody that goes to church goes to heaven. And I had to tell her, no, Hannah Jo, that's not what the Bible says. And, you know, she didn't really understand that. But that thought and that view, I think it hinders people. That if we just go to church, we're supposed to be saved. We're supposed to be on the way to heaven. And we let a lot of things stop us. We let a lot of things, our family or the other church members or the people sitting next to us. I think that I told them in the group text this morning that today is going to be the most important day in somebody's life that's in this building. And I believe that with my whole heart. And I think that we let a lot of things stop us from coming and giving our life to the Lord because we're supposed to be saved or we're supposed to be this or supposed to be that. They'll look at us and they'll know that I was living a lie. I lived a lie. I lived the lie. I would have said I was saved too. But I just want you to understand, don't let nobody stop you. Don't let nothing stop you from coming and giving your life to the Lord if you feel that you have not done it previously. In the same book in Romans, just real quick, I think about this, the testimony and who I say that I am versus who the Bible says that I am. In Romans 1, verse 1 says, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ. And that right there is far enough. You see, we all look for our purpose in this world. Who am I? I'm a minister. I'm a deacon. I'm a church member. I'm a father. I'm this, I'm that. Who you are does not matter. It is not who you are that matters in this world. It is whose you are. It is who you belong to. As Paul says, a servant of Jesus Christ, a servant, a slave. Do you look like a slave? Is that what you look like in your life? A slave to Christ. But it doesn't matter who you are. Just never, always remember that. It is whose you are. It is who you belong to. Are you a servant of Christ this morning? And the text that I really got up here to preach on, it's Romans 3. We done 23. Romans 3, 23, but we'll start at verse 24. Romans 3:24 says, being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. The word justified, that is a word that means it is a legal binding word, that you are legally, friend, declared righteous by a holy God. And it says freely by His grace. You go from a state that you are legally declared unrighteous. In your sin, you are separated from God. It doesn't matter how you feel. It doesn't matter what you think. If you are not in Christ, you are separated from a holy, righteous God. Make no mistake. But the Bible says that you can be legally declared righteous by His grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Now the word redemption, that word comes with the thought of buying back, to redeem something. It means that there was a price that had to be paid for you to be legally declared righteous with God. But that price wasn't paid by you. The price was paid by Him. It was paid by Jesus that you couldn't pay for it. So God sent His Son to pay for your sin on your behalf so that you could legally be declared righteous with Him. Verse 25, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in His blood, to declare His righteousness for the remission of sins that are past, through the forbearance of God. Another very important word in verse 25 is propitiation. This word means that it was a sacrifice. That Jesus Christ was a sacrifice that was accepted to appease and to fulfill the divine judgment of God. That He was sufficient in your place to pay for your sin because you could have never paid for it. And verse 26 says, to declare, I say at this time, His righteousness, that He might be just and the justifier of him which believes in Jesus. Now verse 26 says, to declare all of this, man is in sin. In verse 23, verse 24, you're legally justified by the grace of God. Verse 25, propitiation, that Jesus was a sacrifice that was sufficient. But verse 26 says, to declare His righteousness, that God may be both just and the justifier of him which believes. To declare the righteousness of God, Christ was sent to the cross at Calvary. How does that seem to line up and make sense? Isaiah 53 says, it pleased the Lord to crush Him. It pleased God to crush Jesus up on Calvary, because unless He done so, He would not be righteous. He would not be just. Because as I said, Satan and his angels fell as well. But there was no way of salvation given to them. There was no plan of redemption. There was no mediator. There was no intercession. But yet here we are, a fallen man, ridden in sin, rebel from the holy, righteous God. But we have a plan. God graciously provided us a Savior. How is that fair? How is that just? That we can sin and go against a holy, righteous God, and He can graciously provide us a way. It's because He intervened on our behalf. It wasn't an act, and it wasn't anything that we done. That is the grace, friend. I want you to see God come down and took on flesh and bone and suffered and was tempted. That's another thing I think we forsake and we forget and don't understand, that Jesus was tempted just as we are with sin by the devil himself. Now, if you take me and if you put some weight on my shoulders, I can carry so much and then I begin to break. And if you take someone a little smaller than me, a little less than me, it would take less weight to have them break. Now, what I'm getting at, you take Jesus Christ, that's temptation and what the devil put up on him and tempted him with sin, it was much greater upon his shoulders than what we ever will understand. we would never pass that test. We can never walk around without sin in this world, but he done it. Jesus walked without sin, and then he walked and went to a cross for your sin, to make a way for you to be reconciled to a righteous, holy God. You know, if it was up to you, how would you want God, if you could somehow decide, how just would you want God to be with you? Because there's a lot of things we don't want to hear. The justice of God that comes along with, outside of Christ, as a sinner, as separated, you will be condemned to a lake of fire for all of eternity. For all of eternity, friend. But we don't like to hear that sometimes. But how would you want God to be? Would you want God to be just in a different way? Would you want God to ease up just a little bit? Because I think when it says that he's declaring his righteousness, I think it's because the devil and his angels, those demons, they went to God and they told him, they said, no, look at Adam. He disobeyed you in the garden. He rebelled against your word. He done exactly what you told him not to do. But you're going to let him live? You're going to give him away? Listen to me here. Adam fell. Noah got drunk. Abraham was a liar. Jacob cheated. Moses murdered. Rahab was a prostitute. David fornicated and murdered. Jonah ran. Thomas doubted. Peter denied. Paul persecuted. And every one of us rebelled against a holy, righteous God. But he made us a way of salvation by sending his only Son. That all you have to do is put your faith in him. It is by grace, though, that you are saved. That you will accept that sacrifice given. That God come and made a way for us to be reconciled. And the devil says no. Up until Calvary some 2,000 years ago, Satan said no. Satan said, you, Lord, you are not righteous, because if you was, you wouldn't let them live. You would not let them live. If you was a righteous God, when they sinned against you, you would never use them for your glory. You would never let them live. You would never give them a way out. And 2,000 years ago, God looks to Calvary and he says, Satan, you look at that. You look at my Son upon that cross. I am righteous because it is me. It is I that paid the price for them to make a way. It was God that paid the price for you. It is to declare his righteousness, not yours. And a scripture that came to me is Titus chapter 2. Titus chapter 2, verse 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared to all men. See, it is by grace. It is by grace. And I believe that everybody in this room, that salvation has appeared to you. It is in God's goodness and grace that he supplied it, friend. But it takes the conviction and the drawing of God. Don't forsake his grace. because I do believe that there will be a day that God's grace will be completely removed from you. And it will be a sad day. Verse 12 says, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. God's grace, in His grace, He teaches you and shows you His way. He teaches you and reveals to you His Word. He changes your heart and changes you from the inside. A new spirit. When you're reborn and in Christ, these worldly lust, this ungodliness is all over this world today. Everything I read in the Old Testament of a nation turning its back and rebelling and backsliding and going back into sin and worshiping idols, all I see is America, America, America. That's all I see. But we're supposed to deny worldly lust. Deny that ungodliness. If you will not take a stand against worldly lust and ungodliness, it will come into your home, into your schools, into your house, into your church. It will infect everything if you will not take a stand. And I know that y'all see it. I know that you see it in today's world, even here in the county that we live in. How blessed we are in these mountains, that we don't see everything that the world sees. But verse 13 says, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave Himself for us that He might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto Himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. Are you looking for that hope this morning? Are you looking for that return of Jesus Christ? Because friend, I want to get out of this flesh. I want to get rid of this sin, these things that I can't help from doing and disobeying God and not pleasing Him. I want to get rid of my flesh. I want to go on into glory. I want to just live with Him and dwell with Him like in the garden. I just want to be with Him, walk around with Him. That's all I want. To just be with my Savior. And I think about it. We forget that. We forget that He is alive and present and here. You know, I'm not asking everybody to jump up and raise your hands or run around this building. Make no means. That's not what I'm saying. And I'm not saying it because I want our church to look a certain way or do certain things. But I want to ask you, when you get to heaven and you see Jesus, are you going to just slowly walk up to Him and shake His hand? Or are you going to fall on your knees and cry out and lift your hands and praise Him, please? What are you going to do on that day? Because that day is coming, friend. The day is coming. I only got a few more things here. The word "in" has jumped out to me recently. Being in Christ. Well, this blessed hope, friend, the return of Christ and Jesus coming back, it's approaching. We're in the last days, and we have been for a very long time. But you can see a lot of things going on in the world that really opens your eyes and makes it seems that it is as close as what everybody says it is. And I think about the word "in," and it's starting to rain. No, it ain't years before the rains come. It's starting to rain right now. And all those people that was in the world when Noah was building that ark, they laughed. They thought he was a liar. There is no way. That is not true. I will not believe that. But let me ask you something. If they would have believed him, was that enough to save them? You see, knowing that the ark would float, knowing that the rain will come, it's not enough unless you get in that ark. So knowing who Jesus is, knowing that he's coming back, knowing that you're going to be judged is not enough unless you're going to come and be in Jesus Christ. And I tell you, by no means do you have to be baptized, I believe, to be saved. But it is commanded by Jesus in the Bible. I never looked at it that way. But you are baptized into Jesus Christ. I went years without being baptized until I really took a good look at the scripture. When Jesus says, you are buried with me in baptism. You are raised in new life. Friend, if you're not in Jesus, if you cannot say that I know I'm in Christ, he will profess that he knows me before his Father, and I profess that I know him to the point that he will let me in. Because there is people that I know, and they know me, that if I went to their home, just because I know who they are and they know who I am, they're not going to let me in the house. I know who the president is. But if I go to the White House and say that I know him, is that enough for them to let me in? No. You must intimately know that you are in Christ, that he is your all in all, friend. And just like that ark back when the floods came, if you're not willing to abandon all hope, every bit of hope you have, and put all your faith in Jesus Christ, you will not be saved. You will not be saved. Once again, I have no clue how long I went. If anybody's got a word, if not, if the singers want to come. But the rain's coming. It is raining, friend. What is stopping you today? Because as I said, it felt so strongly this morning that today was the day for somebody. That today was the most important day of someone's life. And if you know that you are in Christ, praise God. Praise God, friend. But if you don't know if you're in Christ, is God pointing out to you that today is that day for you? That today is your day. It is the most important day of your life today. That God is drawing you and speaking to you and telling you that you need to come. That it is only by my grace that you can walk up there, friend. It is nothing of yourself. You are not going to do enough to be pleasing and made righteous before me. But by my grace, I sent my Son to die and pay for all those sins that is so hard for you to avoid.